this is our 35th anniversary. Can you believe it? 35 years of Church of the Rock. And so we're calling this A Blast from the Past, and hence the music, a little worship music from 1987, a little secular music from 1987. And one of the things that I get asked quite often, and it's a long story, is how did the church begin? How did the church start? So tonight I'm going to tell you that story. Some of you know little bits of it. I'm going to try to weave it together and then sort of pull some lessons out of the whole thing, and hopefully it'll be a fun ride for you. 35 years ago, and I can't stop thinking about it all week, because 35 years ago, there's only four people still left in the church from 35 years ago. That would be me, my wife Kathy, our newborn son, who was a week or two old at the time, and my mother, who's still around and the object of my affection, as you can tell in my sermons. And so we're going to tell you this little great story and this great ride. And I want to begin with a verse because I think it's really important for us. And it's 1 Samuel chapter 7, verse 10. It says, "Now as Samuel was offering up burnt offerings, the Philistines drew near to battle against Israel. But the Lord thundered with a loud thunder upon the Philistines that day, so that confused them that they were overcome before Israel. And the men of Israel went out of Mizpah and pursued the Philistines and drove them back as far as below Beth-Kar. Then Samuel took a stone and set it up." He took a stone. Actually, more accurately, it was a rock, a big stone. He took a stone and set it up between Mizpah and Shen and called its name Ebenezer, saying, "Thus far the Lord has helped us." That's what the word Ebenezer means. So the Philistines were subdued, and they did not come any more into the territory of Israel. So what they did was they set up this stone as a memorial, and they called it Ebenezer, and they just reminded themselves that this rock was a testimony of what God had done. And so I thought, you know what we'd do on this 35th anniversary? We'd do a blast from the past. We would look at our story, and then we would, more importantly, look at the lessons that we learned along the way. And every single one of these lessons can apply to you as a person. So let's start with the first one. The first lesson was this: take a licking, but keep on ticking. How many remember where that comes from? The Timex, thank you. A few people got it. Timex watches, that was their slogan for many, many, many years. And how many of you owned a Timex? How many of you at some point in your life, it's getting a smaller and smaller group of people that own a Timex. People don't even wear watches anymore. But in the 1950s, there was a famous newscaster by the name of John Cameron Swayze, and they hired him to be the spokesman. And they took this Timex watch, and they literally kind of beat the tar out of it. They put it on Mickey Mantle's baseball bat. They put it on Ben Hogan's golf clubs. They put it on Rocky Marciano's boxing gloves, and it took a licking, and it kept on ticking. But then they did one thing that was sort of way out of the box, and they did it on live TV. I don't know if you know this, but ads were live on television. They weren't pre-recorded. They had to go do them live on the set of whatever it was. And here was the ad. It's a very grainy picture because it comes from a long time ago. But there he is, John Cameron Swayze, $9.95 for a waterproof Timex. He put it on the prop of an outboard motor, started the motor up, put it down in the water, revved it up in first gear, pulled the motor out, and the watch was gone. And he's apologizing and just kind of rolled with it about how in practice, you know, the watch didn't come off. And anyway, they see it. It's at the bottom of the tank. Took a licking, kept on ticking. There it was, keeping perfect time. And you know, this is a little bit of a picture for us, because what happens in life is you will have tribulation in this world. Is that not what Jesus said? He said, you're going to have trouble. And here's what I've learned. The lesson I've learned about this is that you're going to have opposition. A lot of times the opposition doesn't come from where you think it's going to come from. You think it's going to be some terrorist or some, you know, government agency. And oftentimes it's people right around you that give you the licking. And what our determination is, instead of resisting the opposition that comes to our life, why don't we see it instead that maybe God is setting you up for great things? Because oftentimes that is exactly what it does. He's planning on moving in your life, and somebody is trying to stop you. So I want to tell you the story about how the church began. Kathy and I came to Christ when we were in our 20s, in our early 20s. We came to Christ and we got married all at once. And we started going to this, I don't know, there's no other way to describe it, kind of a wacky charismatic church. And we went to this kind of wacky charismatic church, but it was a lot of fun. And what did we know? We didn't know it was wacky. We didn't have anything to compare it to. And within about 6 months after becoming Christians, Kathy and I were already leading small groups. We were teaching other Christians the Bible. And what's amazing about that is we didn't know anything. We were just making it up as we went along. They didn't know any better, so what difference does it make? So we did that for quite a while, probably another year at least. And then after about a year and a half, probably more like a year and a half, I thought, God's got this call in my life. And if I'm going to do this, I got to stop making things up. I better go to Bible school. So I went to Bible school. And then another 6 months after that, after my Bible school, I got hired by a pastor to be his associate pastor. Are you doing the math on this? I've been a Christian for 2.5 years. Now, that doesn't hardly happen today, but it did in the book of Acts, probably even faster than that. And the man who hired me, his name was Wally Wildman. I don't know how many. Anybody know who Wally Wildman is? Just a couple of people in the room. And Wally was actually the founding pastor of Springs Church. Most people don't know that. Leon doesn't know that. He was a baby in diapers. And I'm kidding, people. So there we were, and I was associate pastor for a couple of years. And after a couple of years, the church decided they were going to send us out, and we were supposed to take over this little struggling, tiny church. It was called Abundant Strife. I mean, Abundant Life is what that always comes out wrong when I say it. And it was a charismatic Mennonite church. And it was truly a match made in heaven. I'll tell you why. Because I was the charismatic and they were the Mennonites. And it was a learning experience for absolutely both of us. And I actually have a picture from the archives. I dug this up out of my album. Here's the picture of Kathy and I on the day that we started with the Abundant Life Church. Look at that. I haven't changed a whit. And Kathy looks 12, so she's changed a little bit. And one of the things you'll notice in these pictures I'm going to show, I had a bit of a penchant for double-breasted suits. And any self-respecting pastor would preach in a double-breasted suit. And I had a whole closet full of them, and I was wearing one earlier tonight that also comes back from 1987. So we took over this church, and there was about 12 people. That's all there was. And within a few weeks, we had gathered a bunch of other people, friends and family, maybe another 30 people. And away we were going, and we thought we were off to the races, and it was growing. And I remember one Sunday I asked one of the women, just like we did tonight, I asked one of the women to get up and lead worship, which she did. At the end of the service, one of the men came to me and said we were having an emergency board meeting. I thought, how exciting is that? An emergency board meeting. I've never done one of those before. And this must be something really important. So we went over to McDonald's for the emergency board meeting and ordered Big Macs. And the question came, and they said, Pastor Mark, what was that woman doing on stage? And I'm super confused. I went, like singing? And they said, no. What was a woman doing on stage? And I didn't realize, this is how clued out I was, I didn't realize that I had breached some sacred thing about women on the platform. Never even dawned on me. And we wrestled through this, and I gave them some explanation about how Miriam, she led in worship after the children of Israel crossed the Red Sea. They opened their Bible and pointed to me where it said she led the women, not the man. I'd never seen that before. Anyway, I realized we were in trouble. So we began this struggle, and I was busy trying to figure out and navigate. These people were good people. Don't misunderstand from this story that these were horrible people. They're actually wonderful people. They had good hearts. They had good intentions. I just misunderstood them, and they really misunderstood me. And sometimes that's what happens. And so after about a year, the church had grown. We were about 70 people. It was cooking along. It didn't look like it used to when we got there with the 12 people. And so those original 12 people, 10 of the 12 left. And then what they decided, they thought, why are we leaving? He should leave. And they called an emergency board meeting, although they weren't the board at that point. And they invited me one Saturday morning. Kathy couldn't come. We had just had a child. And so I went by myself and sat in this room with 10 people who ganged up on me and ripped me a good one for 2 hours. And they were so mad at me. And this is what they had decided they wanted. They wanted, first of all, they wanted me to leave. And then they ramped up and they said, we don't want you to be leave. We want you to be discredited and your reputation ruined. And then they said, we want you to be defrocked and we want you to lose your credentials. And then finally they said, what we really want you is to go to jail. Now, the one thing they didn't want to do is murder me. And that's because they were pacifists. Can I have some fun with this? I can have some fun with this, my story. And so anyway, I said, well, what do you really want? And they said, we want our church back. I said, what's the church? And they said, the name and the bank account. And I said, oh, okay, we had nothing. We had no assets. We had not one single thing. We literally had a shoebox. The whole church was a church in the box. It was in a shoebox. It was our papers and it was our checkbook and a few other things. And so I went and got the shoebox and I gave them the shoebox. And they were happy and they left. And then the next day, a bunch of people, not all of them, because they'd called everybody and told them what a scoundrel I was. And a bunch of people showed up where we were meeting. And I told them what had happened. I told them I'd given the name and the money away. By the way, it was $9,000, which was a lot of money in those days, and especially for a struggling little church. And it didn't belong to those other people. It belonged to the people who were in the room. So by the end of this thing, I had everybody mad at me. Everybody. And so we didn't have a church at that point. So on Monday night, we called a meeting and we said, if anybody's interested in where we go next, this is the inauspicious beginning of Church of the Rock. And they came over. We sat on our back deck at our house. There was about 25 people showed up. They were mostly my friends and my family. And for the most part, they were only there because they felt sorry for me. I mean, genuinely, people were mad at me and disgusted with the whole affair. And I made lots of mistakes, and the other people made lots of mistakes. But there we were. And so we said, why don't we do something new? Why don't we plant a church? And we came up with this name because Matthew chapter 16 says, upon this rock I will build my church, and the gates of hell will not prevail against it. Rock and roll was a big thing in 1987. It's still a big thing today, in case you didn't know. And so we decided to call it Church of the Rock, and we wanted it to be a strong name that even men would want to come to. And so everybody agreed that we would do that. And we said, let's do this. We had a vision for what this church would look like. We decided that it would be fully biblical, that we would never compromise on the Word of God, no matter what, and no matter how unpopular it came and became in the world. We decided that we were going to be a Spirit-led church, that we would always seek to find the power of God in the midst of whatever happened. We decided that we were going to be an evangelistic church, that we would share the gospel with every person we had an opportunity. We decided we were going to be a genuine relational church, highly relational, where people were genuine and real with one another, and we could be vulnerable and transparent with one another. We decided that we were going to be a church that celebrated more often than they mourned and went dark. And we decided we were going to be a place that valued innovation and creativity. How do you think we're doing on all those things? That was 35 years ago we made that decision. But don't miss this fact that we took a licking and we kept on ticking and we got beat up. I would say, honestly, it was one of the most difficult days of my life. I never felt so attacked, so beat up. I've been beat up lots of times by people, but as a young pastor in his first church, to get so eviscerated and so attacked, it was tremendously emotionally difficult. But you know what I do. I forgive everybody all the time. I take a licking, but I keep on ticking. Thank you, Terry, for clapping for that. It's like the guy who took over this new church. It was the very, very first church he'd ever pastored out of Bible school. And he was standing at the back door and he was greeting people and shaking hands. And this woman comes and says, honestly, that was the worst sermon I've ever heard. And she just kept on going. And then she went and stood in the line and they went through again. More people greeted. She goes through again. She says, I'm not kidding. It was a terrible sermon. You probably need to go back to Bible school. And she went around, went back into line again. She came through the third time, and she said, honestly, you might consider other work. I mean, really, this is not your thing. I don't think there's a place for you. by this time, the poor guy is, you know, really, really feeling down and crestfallen. And one of the men said, oh, don't worry about her. She doesn't have an original thought in her head. She's just repeating what she hears everybody else say. So the first thing is this. Throw it up on the screen. The first thing is this. You take a licking, but you keep on ticking. The second thing is, if you obey, God will make a way. And so one of the lessons, one of the big lessons I think we've learned in this journey is that we always need a step of faith. And you know, I always talk about that. I call it a leap of faith, a step of faith. We always need to know that. And so what we did was we actually started our church. I had a friend that was in the real estate business, and he had this property that he had bought, and it was on the corner of Grant and Nathaniel. It was 1213, I think it was, on Grant Avenue, Grant and Nathaniel. And today it's a Royal Bank. It's right across from Grant Park Shopping Center. It's got the zigzag roof like this. And so it had been a church. The church had closed. They were going to make it into a bank. I phoned up my friend, and I said, we need a place to meet. Can we just go meet in there? We'll pay you $500 a month. So he agreed to let us do that. And so we moved into this place, and I got a picture of our first Christmas there. There's our first Christmas in that place. It was a regular church. It had rosewood backing. It had lighting. It had its own carpet. It had a stage. It had a nursery. It had an office. It had washrooms. It had a kids area. It was a full-blown church. I'm wearing another double-breasted suit, just in case you're wondering, because they're awesome. And so anyway, we were allowed to be there for 6 months, and after 6 months, they were going to tear the building down or renovate the building and turn it into a church. And so just before the 6 months was up in our term, their architect who was designing the building, God rest his soul, had a heart attack. And so that was a terrible tragedy for them, but one man's tragedy, right? And so anyway, they had no plans for this. And so they said, you don't need to pay rent because we're going to kick you out of here any day. They left us there. Are you ready for this? Another year. Rent free. We stayed in that place and we built this church, and the church continued to grow. And so then what happened is we knew we had to get out. Finally, they got another architect and they were working forward towards this, and they were going to actually go forward. They gave us 2 weeks notice, and they said, you got to be out in 2 weeks. I'd been looking, couldn't find a place. And so 2 weeks before we moved, I preached a message out of the book of Exodus. You know the one. It's when they came out of Egypt and they were trapped between the Pharaoh's army and the Red Sea. You remember this? And then Moses started to whine to God, and he said, don't whine to me. He says, tell the people to go forward. Do you remember that? There's only one problem with going forward. There was a Red Sea in the way. So here's what I did that Sunday. I preached on that, and I said, everybody was asking the question all morning long, like, where are we going? Like, where's the next place? We're getting kicked out of here. And I said, God's saying to us, tell the people to go forward. So this is what I want you to do next week when you show up. Because we hadn't found a place yet. I said, next week when you show up, I want you to bring your trucks if you have one, your trailer if you want have one, because they've told us when we move out that we can take everything in this building with us if we want. We can take the bathroom fixtures and the stalls, and we can take the doors from the nursery and all this glass and all this thing. They said, we can gut the whole place. So we're going to gut it and we're going to move. They said, Pastor, where are we going? Tell the people to go forward. We'll just show up. I didn't know where we were going. And so then what happened was the next Sunday, I'd found another location. It was a strip mall on Pembina Highway down here where the Arizona Fitness Center was. And we had our service, and then we stripped the walls, and we took everything off the walls and threw it into trailers, and we all hauled it down to this strip mall that was empty. It was just an empty room, and we erected it just the way we took it out. And we put in a nursery, and we put in doors to a sanctuary. We did all this thing. Didn't get a permit. Didn't know you needed a permit. we just did it. It was 1989. You did stuff like that. Nobody thought of anything like that. So anyway, and then we just bumped around, and we went to another part of the same strip mall, actually. In fact, here's a picture of it. There we are, and there, Kathy's looking pretty sharp there, by the way. There's our son, Jordan. That was starting Church of the Rock was a busy week for us because I lost my job, had a baby, and planted a church all in the same week. It was a great week. But there you can see Block Brothers Real Estate. That was their office. Remember those guys? They were in the real estate business. They went broke. We were in the real estate office having church. And by the way, that is half of a beautiful double-breasted suit, in case you're wondering what my jacket looks like. And so here's what I learned in that, was that the key to this is if you obey, God will make a way. And I think that's a principle in life. When God tells you to do something, you got to step forward and do it. So the third thing is this, and it's really an important thing. And it's this, give the call and invite them all. So take a lick and keep on ticking. If you obey, God will make a way. Give the call and invite them all. So eventually we ended up in Chevrier, 1111 Chevrier, which was the Trinity Television Building. How many of you remember Willard and Betty Teason? Is that ringing a bell with a bunch of you? They were good friends of ours. They built that great building on Chevrier, and they needed to fill it with stuff, and so they invited us. We needed to find another place. We were in these strip malls moving around. Our slogan became, "You can join us if you can find us." And so finally we moved into there, and they opened up a place for us. We spent 6 years with them, and it was a great location. But there was something significant that happened in there. Pastor Keith came in 1994, and so that's a big piece of our history. But I want to tell you about what happened in 1995. There was a revival going down in Pensacola, Florida. It was called the Brownsville Revival. It was in a big Pentecostal church called the Brownsville Assembly. And they had thousands and thousands of people were coming in from all over the world, and people were getting saved. And this revival had gone on for about a year and a half. And after about 6 or 8 months, we went down. There was 11 of us went down there, and we wanted to see what the fuss was about. And it was really remarkable. People were lining up outside the doors of a church every single night for 4 or 6 or 8 hours to go to church. I thought, I've never seen people lining up, because otherwise they wouldn't get in and they wouldn't get a seat. And so we went and stood in line in the hot Florida sun, and we got into this building, and this event started, and we had... The pastor's name was John Kilpatrick, and he had an evangelist there that did the preaching. And his name was Steve Hill, and he was this fiery preacher, and God had truly anointed him. But I'll tell you, it was some kind of revival that I'd never seen before, because the sort of Southern Pentecostal message of the day was, if you have any sin in your life, you're going straight to hell. And so these people, many of these people were getting saved, actually were already saved, but you know, the way they presented the gospel, if you had sin in your life, well, you better get it right. So I'm sitting there, and at the end of the message, he preached a fiery message, and at the end of the message, he said, if you have something in your life that's holding you back, if you have something that's not right in your life, I want you to come forward. I'm sitting there thinking, doesn't everybody have something not right in their life? Of course I have. So I got up and I went to the front. And I didn't realize, I thought I was in something else. I didn't realize I was in the altar call. I didn't realize I was getting saved. And so then when they brought me this card to fill out, a decision card to accept Christ, I said to him, but you don't understand. I'm a pastor. To which she said, praise the Lord, another pastor got saved. And I thought, oh, I'm really into this one, I'll tell you. And so anyway, I filled out the card, you know, when in Rome, do as the Romans do. Now, the next day we took the pastor, John Kilpatrick, we took him out for lunch. There was 11 of us, and he wanted to meet these 11 pastors from Winnipeg. And we sat down with him, and he's telling us the story of this revival. And he says, so far we've had 20,000 people saved, and 25 pastors have actually come to Christ. To which I said, make that 26. I got saved last night. To which he went, no joke. He was, praise the Lord. Praise the Lord. He just accepted that. I was kidding, of course. Hopefully I was saved. And so anyway, we had a great meeting with him. And so it was sort of a marvel to me to see what was going on. What was God doing in this place? And so we were there 4 nights. And on the 4th night, I'm watching this happen again. I'm watching hundreds of people come to Christ night after night after night after night. I'm seeing all these people lining up outside, and God spoke to me as clear as day. He's only spoken to me a few times like this in my entire life. And he said, you can do this. And what he meant, he didn't mean that I could do that Southern Pentecostal thing that I'm talking about. What he meant was that I could be inviting people to come to Christ, which was something we didn't do. We almost never did that in our church. And I made a decision that night that I was going to, and every time we had a service, every time our doors were open and we had people in the room that I might not know some of them, that we were going to give an invitation and that we were going to allow people the opportunity to come to Christ. So I started doing it. Now understand this. We've got about, 150 people in the church. I know every single person in there for the most part. And every Sunday morning, week after week, I'm giving an invitation for people to come to Christ, and nobody is responding. And this went on not for a couple of weeks. It went on for months. And week after week, I gave the invitation. I had leaders coming to me and saying, Pastor Mark, it's embarrassing what you're doing. You're giving this invitation. Nobody's coming to Christ. Why are you doing that? Why don't you do it once a month? It's bothersome for us. And I said, I made a commitment to God that I was going to give this invitation every time I stood up and every time I preached. So I'm going to keep on doing it until someone gets saved so we could start with you. And so, anyway, after several months, a gal from the back, I didn't even call her forward, but a gal from the back got up and walked down to the aisle, came to the front, knelt down on the front, and gave her life to Christ. And she had one serious messed up story. They were in this multiple person relationship. It was really a terrible story. And she gave her heart to Christ, and she became one of our most dedicated followers and a leader in the church. And God did wondrous things. But I'll tell you what it did was it broke the dam. And then a few weeks later, another person came to Christ. And then a couple weeks later, another person came to Christ. And it wasn't very long before people were coming to Christ every single week. And do you know what? That was 27 years ago. And we have, I don't think we've ever missed a Sunday in 27 years. Now, sometimes in a service, nobody comes, but we've never missed a weekend where someone didn't come to Christ every single weekend. For 27 years. That's how faithful God is. That's how faithful God is. And so if we give the call and invite them all. Lesson number four is your future space might be right in front of your face. And so I've often talked to you about this, that a lot of times your destiny is right under your nose. And then in the scripture, it uses this expression, lift up your eyes. And they lift up their eyes and they see their destiny. And I could quote dozens of scriptures like that where God simply told people to lift up their eyes. Just look in front of you. So a lot of times our future space is right in front of our face. So I told you a story that we were meeting in the Trinity Television building. And we had been now seeing people come to Christ. The year was 1996. And God gave me a dream. I've shared this before, so I'll give you the very abbreviated version of it. God gave me a dream about TV ministry, and dreams are hard to explain. You know how that works, but it was streetlights, and it wasn't red, and it wasn't green. It was a blinking yellow, which means go very, very fast, right? Isn't that what blinking yellow? No, it means proceed with caution. And so God gave me this word. I thought it was for somebody else. I've told you that story before. And so eventually I realized God spoke to me. And when I was trying to give the word to someone else, the Lord spoke to me and said, it's for you, dummy. Sometimes God speaks to me like that. And he probably speaks to you like that too. And I realized it was for us. And here was the funny part of this story. We were meeting in a television studio. Remember, we met in Trinity Television. We had television lights facing the stage. We had television cameras in the next room on big, long cords. We had a guy named Ernie Nathaniel, who has been working with me as our producer of our show. He was a TV producer sitting in the pew, and he's been producing our show now for 26 years. He was sitting there. And it was all in front of us. And so we just made that decision because God spoke to me that we needed to go for it and we needed to do the same. I had no intention of doing television ministry. Why would I do television ministry? And so we decided to go for it, and we started to ask around. The Trinity Television said yes, they would rent us the equipment. We talked to MTN, which was out in Portage la Prairie at that time, and they said yes. And so all of a sudden, the next thing you know, we were on television. I don't know if you know this, as of next week, we'll be airing, are you ready for this? Our 800th episode as of next week. That's a lot of episodes. That's a lot of talking, blah, blah, blah. And And not only that, we're in every major city across Canada. We just kept on going. And today it is still the single most watched religious program in Canada. And we never talk about this. We never mention it to you. But we actually have 200,000 viewers. And it's a crazy thing. Lesson number five is, if you decide, God will provide. I may not get through all of these tonight, but we'll see how this goes. If you will decide, God will provide. I have lots of stories. I'm just going to tell you one. And so when we made this decision to do the television ministry, how do you do television ministry? It's super expensive. Do you know how much that camera is that's sitting right there? That's $100,000. And that one's $100,000. And that one's where is it? There it is. And it goes on and on and on. And so I thought, how are we ever going to afford this in the long run? And so we made this decision that what we were going to do is we were going to always rely on God. If you decide, God will provide. And we decided that we were never going to ask for money. Never once were we going to ask for money. And we told the congregation, if for some reason the money doesn't come in some way, miraculously, we're going to go off air. We're not going to just... televangelists had a really bad reputation in those days. And they were always on air. They were always asking for money. They were always saying, if we don't get money, we're going to go off the air. And they went on like that. And I thought, I don't want to do that. Nobody else wanted me to do that. So we decided we were just going to let the cameras eavesdrop on us. And if God provided the money, then so be it. And the amazing thing was, we just added city after city after city after city. And after all these years, our annual airtime bill is $400,000 a year. And do you know that money all comes in from outside? And we've never once in 26 years asked people for money. If you decide, God will provide. You do know how many televangelists it takes to change a light bulb, don't you? Only one. But if you want that eternal flame to keep burning, send your generous donation today. I bet you hadn't heard that one. All right. So let's throw them up again here. Quick review. Take a licking, keep on ticking. If you obey, God will make a way. Give a call and invite them all. Your future space is right in front of your face. If you decide, God will provide. And then this one. Growth comes when you live to give. This is really an important principle that we learned. We teach this for you, right? That do not be mocked, do not be deceived. God will not be mocked, for whatever you sow, you will also reap. And we always teach that for you, but we actually practice it as a church. And we decided right from day one that we were going to be a generous church and that we were always going to give. And we were going to seek to give before we sought to get. And we were only a few months old after we had planted the church in 1987. A friend of mine was in a building project. They were having to move out of a rented facility and into a building, and they were really strapped for cash. We had a grand total in our entire bank account of Church of the Rock of $1,500. And we had a board meeting and decided to give them the whole amount. I mean, I know it doesn't sound like a lot of money, but when you have very little money, if you only have $1,500, that's a lot of money. So we gave them $1,500. And we started, actually, every time there was a building project of a church we were related to in some way, we would give them $1,500. And so we were giving $1,500 here and $1,500 there and $1,500 there. And we started doing this with regularity. And then we started up that and started giving them $3,000 and then $5,000. And we've actually gave a couple of churches $25,000. And most recently, Gateway Church is building a new building in West St. Paul. You probably don't know this, and you're going to hear it tonight. We gave them $50,000 for their building project. Yeah. And we found that you cannot outgive God. And one of the things, we've just made this a priority. And here's something, unless you're at the annual meeting, you're not going to know this. I didn't even know this. I was blown away. I had to have them verify the numbers. Do you know, as far as missions giving, we last year surpassed $20 million in missions giving last year? How do you love about them apples? And I'll tell you something really funny about it, because we've always made missions a big priority. And this roof here in this building, you probably know this, that for many years it leaked. And it always leaked on pie auction, because pie auction was always in the spring, and the snow would start melting on the roof. And right over there, primarily, there was a huge leak. And we had this pie auction one day. Well, let me just back up for a second. Here's the deal on this roof. We have a 4-acre roof. And the price tag to re-roof the roof, which is what it needed, it didn't just need repairing, it needed re-roofing, it was well past due, was $2 million. And we thought, we could go and we could raise money for the roof, or we could raise money for missions. Let's go with the missions. And we left this roof leaking and had pails and giant garbage cans all over the building. And so we were having this pie auction one day, this is about 6 years ago, and it wasn't dripping. It was raining in the building. And right over there was 30 garbage cans, and it was dripping like this, and it was so loud you could barely hear the music and the preaching. It was dripping away, and we had all the chairs moved out, and it was dripping like crazy, and we never mentioned it. We never mentioned the fact that people are used to it raining on pie auction day, so we never brought it up. And that day we raised $250,000 for the 1040 window. And this guy came up to me at the end of the service and he says, this is my first time in this church, but he says, I'll be back. And I said, why is that? He says, I've never in my life been in a church where the roof is leaking like a sieve and it's dripping water all over the place and you never even talk about your roof and you're busy raising hundreds of thousands of dollars for missions. That's a church I want to be part of. Isn't that a cool story? And instead, what we did, we actually saved for 10 years. We did the roof last year, by the way. But it took us 10 years to save. All right, just quick review. Run through them all again one more time. Take a licking, but keep on ticking. If you obey, God will make a way. Give the call and invite them all. Your future space may be in front of your face. If you decide, God will provide. Growth comes when you live to give. God's always taking care of us. And the last and final thing, lesson 7, if you think enormous, God will do ginormous. See how I rhymed all of these? Just like blasts from the past. And so let me just end with this thought about this. We know this, that God says that he can do more abundantly than you can ask or think. Is that what he says? He will do exceedingly abundantly beyond what you can think or ask. Whatever you can dream, whatever you can ask, he will do and go beyond. If you think enormous, he will do ginormous. If God is your partner, make big plans, someone once said. And that's a good lesson for us. And when people ask me this question, they say, Pastor Mark, 35 years ago, did you see all of this? I'd love to say yes. I'd love to say I'm such a visionary. I saw all of this. But I would be kidding. All I had was this vision for this church, which I described at the beginning of this message. They would have those characteristics. And if you stay on mission, God will take care of the rest. I never dreamed that we would be in a building that's 4 acres in size, never in a million years. I never dreamed that we would have 4 other campuses alongside. I never dreamed that we'd be on television from coast to coast. I never dreamed that we would be going online every single week with thousands of people on the internet. There was no internet. How could I even dream of that? I never dreamed that we would be giving $20 million to missions. And here's what I know, people. Our best days are actually yet to come. Because he ain't finished with us. Don't think that because we're celebrating 35 years of Church of the Rock that this is all there is. Whatever he has for us, whatever we can dream, if we can think enormous, God is going to do ginormous. 35 years, people. But let me tell you, this is just the beginning, and our best days are yet to come. Let's stand together.